AreaSports.net proudly presents The Sports Couch. The Sports Couch, one of the area's longest running local sports talk shows, featuring interviews with area coaches, athletes, and other media personnel covering the sports in our area. Who will be on the couch this morning? Let's find out. The Sports Couch starts now. And hello again, sports fans. Welcome to another edition of the Sports Couch. We're starting a couple minutes early today, I guess you'd say, but that's because we've got so many guests on the show with us. Six different guests joining us on the Sports Couch. A busy weekend of boys and girls basketball. I'm Randy Olson along with Danny Anselment. And, a lot of games around the area last night, Danny. And, of course, a lot of games today as everybody's playing catch-up after the snow, and you're seeing a lot of schools double up today and do doubleheaders, sometimes a doubleheader with a girls' game and a boys' game, or in the case of your Foxes, they're doing girls and boys, and the boys are playing a doubleheader. So,
got six games today.
Yeah, you're going to be a tired guy.
Six games between noon and sometime tonight.
You're going to be a tired guy. You think Billy will last the whole time?
I hope so.
Yeah, boy.
I hope so. It's going to be a long day of basketball.
It is going to be a long day of basketball, but a lot of great games around the area last night. We'll get into the scoreboard in just a second. Let's talk about who's going to be on the show today. We're going to have Coach Scott McElravy of the Fairfield Mules on in just a moment, talk about his team's win last night over Johnson City, and also preview their game today against Wayne City. Also, we're going to have Coach Joe Hosman of the Massac County Patriots on the show with us. Coach Hosman and the Patriots are still unbeaten on the year, Danny.
Yeah, you know, his team's rolling along down there. Be interesting to hear from Joe. He's one of the good guys of high school basketball.
He sure is. Been doing it a long time, and he's now coaching his grandson.
No, it's not his son.
His son, okay.
His son.
Oh, that's right. We thought it was his grandson,
yeah,
but it's his son I remember him sharing that story with us the last time.
Yeah, it's his son.
Yeah, okay. That will be fun. That'll be fun to talk to Joe. Also, we'll have Coach Doug Miller of the Hamilton County Foxes on with us. They lost a nail-biter last night in overtime to El Dorado. We'll talk to him about that, and then preview two games that the Foxes are playing today.
Yeah, they're going to have the Johnson City Indians and the NCOE Fighting Cardinals, two big challenges today.
All right. Also, we'll visit with Coach Rob Flanagan of the Olney Tigers, as they lost a tough one last night, but they've been having a good start to the season this year. I'm going to catch up with him and how the Tigers are doing this year. They've completely revamped their gymnasium and done a lot of things up there, so we got a lot to talk to Rob about this morning there from Olney. We'll also visit with Coach Andy Fehrenbacher of the Salem Wildcats, as they're playing without one of their starters this year, who had already moved to Arizona before this pandemic thing. You know, we started knowing we were going to have a season, so he's playing without one of those players, but they're still having some success up there. We'll talk to Andy about that. And then we're going to talk to another coach who has an undefeated team, just like the Massac County Patriots do, the Cobden Apple Knockers. They're kind of flying underneath the radar screen, Danny, with a lot of people, but if you look at 1A basketball, Cobden may very well be the best 1A team in this part of the state. It's hard to argue with that. They're undefeated so far. They're beating teams really bad, and they've got a lot of talent back from a team that was good last year.
Yeah, you know, I hear they've got a 6'5 kid that's probably one of the better players in the South.
Yeah. Yeah, the Franklin brothers on that team. Coach Wendell Wheeler of the Cobden Apple Knockers will join us. And Coach Wheeler's been a lot of different places in his career, too. And he's having a good time down there at Cobden, so we'll visit with him this morning on the Sports Couch as well. So six different guests to come along. So sit back and enjoy it with us this morning. Next 90 minutes of great local sports talk here on AreaSports.net. Danny's going to run down the scoreboard, a busy one from last night.
All right, from the Black Diamond, Fairfield defeated Johnson City 77-38. The Foxes fall to El Dorado 48-46 in overtime in a game that was supposed to be played in Hamilton County and had a blackout down there last night. So they got the game switched to El Dorado, and what a game down there. Carmi 55, Edwards County 44, Gorerville 57, Trico 39, Chester 70, ZR 49, Cesar Valera 49, Vianna 45. From South 7, Mount Vernon 63, Carbondale 33, Centralia over Marion 62-57. From Midland Trail, Woodlawn beat Christ Our Rock 59-54. It was Sisney over Waltonville 61-36. Wayne City beat Weber 65-50. And Patoka 51, Sandoval 39. From the River to River, Massac County remained unbeaten 50-41 at Murphy. Nashville 46-AJ-19. Wayne Harry would have told us, well, yeah, we held them to 19, but which probably should have only been 15. Pinckneyville 61, Sparta 18. That's the final time those two teams will play as Sparta's leaving the conference.
That's right.
Carterville 71, DuCoin 43. Benton beat Heron 37-34. Randy Smith-Peters picks up coaching victory 500 last night with a 67-34 victory over West Frankfort. From the Little Illini, Casey Westfield 54, Olney 37, Marshall 68, Red Hill 59. Newton and Flora, that was a defensive battle, 29-28. Robinson 49, Lawrenceville 40. Mount Carmel wins without the big guy last night as he's injured. Appleby is 42-31. In a game that would have been a great game to see, Muhammad Seymour give Effingham their first loss of the season, 62-61. T-Town 70, Mount Toon 50. Effingham St. Anthony 58, Stu Straws 35. Altamont 72, North Clay 39. Breeze Mater Dei 65, Granite City 54. Cobden remains undefeated. They defeat Elvarado 66-22. Crab Orchard 70, Galatia 51, Dietrich 55, South Central 50, Greenville 47, Piazza Southwest 49. Hardin County beat Pope County 69-45, and Neoga over Cowden-Herrick 55-35.
Yeah, busy scoreboard, and you can see all those, of course, on our website here at AreaSports.net. You mentioned that game between Benton and Heron. You know, they played each other two nights in a row, and that's the thing that's unique about this whole pandemic deal and doing the scheduling is, you know, you got to reschedule games and you're running out of time because, you know, we're going to be transitioning into football. So Benton and Heron played each other on back-to-back nights at each other's place.
Foxes go to Johnson City on Monday night and Tuesday.
Yeah, isn't that something? Yeah, and Mount Vernon's doing that with Belleville Altoff tonight after just playing them
Tuesday.
Well, yeah, 4 or 5 nights ago. So, yeah, you do what you got to do to get these games in, particularly conference games. And so it's important. Well, last night the Fairfield Mules beat the Johnson City Indians at the Mule Barn 77-38, a game that many of you saw on AreaSports.net, and it is archived on there as well. And let's visit with Coach Scott McElravy to talk about it right now. Good morning, Scott. How are you?
Hey, good morning, guys.
Good to have you on the show. How are you doing today?
Doing well.
Yeah, nice win last night, not only for the varsity, but for the freshman JV, too. Another triple-header sweep for the Mules.
Yeah, always good to get each of the three teams a game each night, you know, like you guys were talking about. It almost it's almost like the NBA where you have series. You know, you have teams mm-hmm. that are playing stuff back-to-back nights and that sort of thing. But, yeah, it was good to get a win against Johnson City, and this is their last year that we get to play them as well. So
that's right, Coach. They'll be moving to the Black Diamond West as Flora comes into the conference next season.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's a good move for Johnson City. A lot more centrally located. They don't have to travel as much. And then I like the addition of Flora. You know, they were in our conference for 80 years. We've talked about that before.
Mm-hmm.
Coach Lieb does a good job, so it'll be fun.
Well, Flora's a good addition both for basketball and for football, I believe. You know?
Oh, yeah. I mean, and they've got, you know, all the sports, boys mm-hmm. and girls, they're usually pretty competitive and quite a few of them, so it'll be fun.
Yeah. Well, last night, again, another triple-header sweep for the Mules. You did that also earlier in the week against Carmine, did it last week against the Foxes. And I'm just continuing to see improvement at all three levels. I thought your freshmen were really aggressive last night. They've really kind of picked up the pace on defense. Saw a lot more out of them defensively last night than what we'd seen previously. And then your JV just continues to improve as well.
Yeah, the freshmen took it on the chin Wednesday over at Mount Vernon. Mount Vernon's freshmen mm-hmm. are pretty good, you know, and you just see a different style over there. So they were itching to get back out on the floor. And it's tough. You know, they didn't have a summer in the program to get going, you know, and then didn't have much time before we started playing games. And then once we start playing games, there's just not a lot of practice time, and the freshmen really need that. JV and varsity as well, but the freshmen, they're new. You know, they've all played against pretty much each other since we have all the different feeder schools. So they're improving, and JV keeps playing well. I mean, really excited about that group. And I was really pleased with the varsity last night and how we shared the ball. You know, too bad for Austin Brown. We didn't know he wasn't going to be there. Mm-hmm. At the very end of that Carmine game, he had an unfortunate fall. I mean, he's a D1 football athlete, so
yep.
You like to have a chance to play against kids like that.
Yeah, that's right. It was a shame that he couldn't play last night because they're a different team without him on the floor. There's no question about that. But, yeah, back to your freshman, losing at Mount Vernon, there's no shame in losing to the Rams freshman team. I mean, that's the team that won the Class L state championship last year in grade school, so they are pretty talented. But it sounds to me like that Coach Lackey and those freshman Mules learned a lot from that loss, and they did come out with a lot more intensity last night.
I think so, and that – I had forgot that about Class L, and I can definitely believe it. They had size, they had speed, very good freshman team.
Yeah. Yeah, well, hey, you got a high noon shootout today against the Wayne City Indians, a team that you certainly can't take lightly. Again, on paper, you're the favorite, but you know they bring some size in there with the 6'6 and 6'4 guys in the middle, and then, of course, you got Taj McKinney, who is a really, really fast guard, very strong, and heck of a leaper for them, too, and you're going to have to try to find a way to contain him, and he had 41 points in the game against NCOE. So
he had 35 last night.
Yeah, and so you can't take him lightly, so, again, you got to go out and try to take care of business, don't you?
Yeah, these are kids that have played against each other throughout junior high, you know, playing multiple times there. You know, Taj is a 1,000-point scorer as a junior. That's a lot of points.
Yeah.
That tells you that he knows how to put it in the hole. They've got some big kids. I think they're all back. You know, they had some games where injuries and whatnot, they weren't all together. But I'm glad, hopefully they're full strength. So, you know, definitely can't take them lightly. They'll come in and want to knock us off, and I would too.
Well, and it hasn't been that long ago that they did knock you off. They came in and surprised the Mules. And so, you know, some of you probably remember that in the back of your mind, don't you?
We do. Yeah, and you know, it's good to, you know, noon game, 15-minute drive for them, kids get in another game, you know, on the weekend, and then they've got the rest of the day to relax. The next 2 weeks for us are big. We've got 4 games next week and actually 5 the very last one. So it's going to be a busy 2 weeks.
Yeah, it really is. Besides the Black Diamond Conference schedule, the 2 non-conference games that you have still coming up, you're going to be traveling to the Hilltop in Mount Carmel playing the Aces, and also, of course, you're going to be traveling to Centralia to play the Orphans. Anybody else I'm missing non-conference-wise on the schedule?
Actually, next Wednesday at North City, I believe they're still undefeated, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, so, I think that's right, yeah.
This is one of the better North City teams they've had in a while, so I know they reached out to us and us as well to them, really wanting to play that game. So that should be a heck of a game this Wednesday.
Where's that going to be at, Coach?
At North City.
Yeah, yeah. Unfortunately, we won't be able to do that one because they signed up with the NFHS contract, so we won't be able to do that
one. Can we break that for one night?
I'd like to. We'd like to, yeah. Yeah, we can't be there for that one, unfortunately. Joe Melton, though, he's going to be quite an athlete for you to contend with. At 6'7", can play both inside and outside. He's a good athlete.
Nice player. Him and Landon have played a lot of basketball together. Noah's played with him a little bit as well. Good kid. They've got some shooters. They've got a really quick point guard and high money. They're a nice team.
Yeah.
So it'd be fun to play them next Wednesday.
For a slight fee, a steak supper or something, I'll make sure I don't lock you out of the broadcast tonight so you can do a little scouting as the Foxes are going to play in COE.
I'm sure I'll talk to Coach Miller about that. And I haven't mentioned anything about Michigan State, Illinois. I'm not real happy about that with your partner there.
Yeah, I tell you what, that was a pretty cheap shot ball game. It's bad that Michigan State has resulted to that.
Well, hey, then we turned around and beat number 4 Ohio State, so it's been a pretty good week for Sparty basketball.
You've had 2 good wins. We'll just keep it at that.
Yeah, 2 good wins. That might be good enough to get Sparty in the tournament. Might be.
I would say you're right.
Yeah. I'd say probably so.
Yeah, might be. But, yeah, I was talking to Jeff Wise last night, who helped me on the broadcast about Kentucky basketball. He didn't have a whole lot of good things to say about UK this year. It's been a tough year for the Blue Bloods.
It has. Yes, it has. Kind of odd, but
very odd.
A couple of them in there together, yeah.
Yeah, it's been a very, very odd year.
It's been odd everywhere.
Yeah, it sure has.
You know,
now let's get out of that situation.
Oh, my goodness. You know, you take the Foxes last night. We were supposed to have a home game, and then the power goes out in the whole city of McLeansboro, and at the last minute we transfer to El Dorado. And Greg Goodley, I was talking to him after the game. He said, yeah, he said, this is just how the seasons win. He said, my wife and family, we had just sat down at the Mexican restaurant to eat. Doug Miller calls me and said, hey, we need to come to your place. The power's out up here. He said, I told the lady at the Mexican restaurant, throw that in a box, leave the ticket on the table. I got to go.
Well, I had no idea that happened.
Yeah.
That's a crazy night, isn't it? Really crazy. Yeah.
Yeah.
But they made it work, so kudos to El Dorado for putting that together real quick and hosting it on short notice. So, yeah, glad they got the game
in. And there was four people from El Dorado found out about it because they had four fans in the stand. And I thought one of the guys was going to get tossed.
That is one gym that just doesn't seem the same without fans. It's
no.
It's so neat of a place when you've got the El Dorado tournament and it's packed. That's just such a fun place to be.
You know, Coach, that's what I said last night. That game went into overtime. It was 48-46. And I said, it's just an absolute shame that this place wasn't about two-thirds full with purple and green last night. The atmosphere would have been unbelievable.
Yeah.
Yep, probably so. Well, Coach, we'll let you go so you can get ready for today, and we'll see you at the Mule Barn for that 12 noon shootout with Wayne City, all right?
Hey, I appreciate it, guys.
Good luck to you, Coach.
Take care. All right, thanks. Bye-bye. That's Head Coach Scott McElravy of the Fairfield Mules. Again, another convincing win last night over Johnson City. But, again, they were playing without Brown last night, and that's a shame. And, you know, hopefully he'll be back at it today against the Foxes because Johnson City's definitely a different team without him. And, you know, they didn't even have time to really game plan or change anything since it happened late in the game the night before.
Yeah.
So,
you know, it's injuries are a big thing, and we thought it would be probably this season. We thought there would Appleby's out up at Mount Carmel. He's their best player up there, and he's a big kid, and it's changed the way they have to play, and Brown's out. And I'd say every team's probably got somebody banged up. Foxes, Tyce Gordon started 3 days before the season started, dislocated a kneecap, and he's not 100%. He's trying to play, and it's been a year. That's all you can say. It's been one challenge right after another. Mother Nature come in, and she played havoc for a whole week, and it's made things even worse now, trying to cram a season into 5 weeks, and now Mother Nature took another week out of it, so it's really created havoc.
It has, but through all of this, the weather, the COVID, and everything, the Massac County Patriots just keep cruising along, and they're still unbeaten on the season, Danny. And with us on the phone right now is the head coach of the Patriots. That's Joe Hosman. Good morning, Coach. How are you?
Well, I just got done watching the Foxes and the El Dorado Eagles play and listened a little bit there to a few good guys. And so trying to get ready for another game. It's just like you guys just said, it's just coming at us, and it's going to go by too fast. And the dang games are, you don't have any time to practice to get better, work on mistakes, and try to get better some stuff. And so it's really been a hectic season.
Yeah, you know, Coach, when I talk to coaches around the area, that's one of the biggest things they say is missing is the opportunity to have time. Said, this is just kind of like summer basketball. You're just going and playing right now and don't have time to really work on things and get ready and try to build and make your teams better. And said that's one of the biggest challenges for coaching right now.
It is, and it's really, you don't even have time to look at the film that you want to look at as far as with a team. Today, the kids will go in 11:30 and kind of prepare for El Dorado as best we can. And I don't like practicing on Sundays, but it's a church day. But we have two this Sunday because we go Monday, Tuesday again, and we'll go from like 2:30 to 4. But I'll tell you what, these last 2 weeks I've done discussed with my coaches, we'll give them the kids off Wednesday because they have to play Friday, Saturday, and then they have to come back Monday, Tuesday, and then Saturday. So we're not getting them on the floor on Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
If anything, we'll look at some film, but they're not going to stay after school. I'm sending them home just because I want their legs fresh and I want their minds a little bit fresh.
Yeah.
If you don't get a day off sometime, it's just tough on young kids.
Yeah, Coach.
On old coaches.
Yeah, you know, Coach, this has been a very trying year for everybody. You know, even last night, we're prepared to go to Hamilton County. And about an hour before the game's supposed to tip, the power goes off. The whole town of McLeansboro is totally black. So they call the bus driver and say, hey, could you come and drive the bus if we can get El Dorado? And Greg Goodley was sitting at the table getting ready to eat Mexican restaurant, and Doug Miller called him, and he took his food to go, and we was able to get down there. The bus driver come in on two wheels honking her horn for the boys to get on the bus because we needed to roll, you know. And, it's just seems like one thing after another.
That's what we heard on the way home because we always check scores and things. And but you talked about Greg Goose. He played for me, and he's the kind of guy that gets stuff done, I can guarantee you.
Yep. Anyway, we had a – had a hard-fought game down there last night. It was
a good game.
It was quite a battle.
I just got done watching it, and you guys got all juniors, so I think you got a chance to have a really good team next year.
Yep. Talk a little bit about your team. You're off to this 7-0 start. How's your team doing compared to where you thought you would be?
Well, you know, I'm pleasantly surprised. We play two freshmen and two sophomores, and I looked up at West Frankfort the other night in the game, and we had two freshmen and three sophomores, and we played two seniors. We lost a really good little senior that went to Paducah, and that's when we didn't know if we was going to have ball in Kentucky. And he's gone over there to play. And my two seniors, Kyler McIntosh and J.J. Sweat, and, you know, doing a good job for us. And then I think my son at point guard is just – he's our leading scorer. And he tied the school assist record, and he's playing well. We got another little freshman that comes off the bench that had 17 against Murfreesboro in a big win the first time. And I have two sophomores that are just tough as nails, named Brody Smallman and Brady Sissel. And Brady has just been playing great. He's getting 9-10 rebounds every night, 8 or 9 points. And then Brody has struggled a little bit shooting, but he just guards anybody. So it's been a pleasant surprise, and I'm really pleased to where we're at, but you just don't have time to take a breath.
Yeah, you know, as you said, it's just let's strap them on and go play again.
Yeah, and you know what? It's the kids are getting to play, and that's the thing. I'm so thankful that we have had some type of season. You know, but I don't understand why these kids have to wear a mask out on the floor, and I'm giving some views here, and I think we could have been doing this in December, you know, and that's just the way I think. Mm-hmm. And so, but they're getting to play, and I am very thankful for that. And I know you guys don't even maybe not know about it, but I have a grandson that lives in El Dorado. That's Andrew, my third son, and he was diagnosed with cancer before Christmas, and the good Lord and prayers is going to get him out of this. And his name's Graham Hosman, and people in different towns and things have been so supportive and given to my son and his family. And I just want you guys and anybody that will lift his name up. His name is Graham.
Yeah, Coach, I knew that was going on, and I didn't know if that's something you wanted to talk about this morning or not.
Nope, I want more people to know about it because I'm a guy that believes in prayer. So,
what age is Graham?
He's 5.
He's 5.
And the only thing that matters to Graham now is he's going to end up being an El Dorado Eagle. And since I won't be coaching at that time, I sure will pull for it.
Yeah, well, that's all right. Well, what's it been like for you coaching your son this year?
It's been a pleasure. He is a very, very unselfish player. He had 14 assists against West Frankfort. He was a little upset that I didn't lead him in a few more minutes, but we were up. And I told him, and he tied with his two brothers. So
okay.
I get to hold it for a while, and if he was a senior, I'd left him in there to get it. But he really can pass the basketball, and he's our leading scorer. And so he's been a pleasure to he's been a pleasure to coach. He's a fun kid to watch play, but more importantly, he's a good kid.
Well, Coach, I'll just tell you what the scuttlebutt about him on the street is. They said that Joe saved the best for last.
Well, his big brothers think that too, so most people ask if he's my grandson. It kind of hurts my feelings, but that's okay.
Yeah, most people think he is your grandson.
Oh, there's no doubt. But like I said, I've been blessed in a lot of ways, and we've had six girls, and I love them all, and I think we got the boy down the stretch, and I hope to continue to coach him for the next 3 years.
Yeah, that's great. Well, that was a big win last night over Murfreesboro, 50-41. And
you know, we've really had a stretch over them. You know how good Coach Murphy's team is.
Sure.
I think we've beat them something like seven times in a row, and that just doesn't happen.
No.
It was a great win for us.
No, they're good in their building, and you're right. Coach Murphy does a good job and always has them prepared.
Yeah.
Well, a big game for you tonight. You know, you're a longtime coach down there at El Dorado, and I'm sure every time you face those guys, some good memories come back for you there, and it's always neat to compete against your former team.
Well, you know what, and they gave me my start, and I'm so thankful. I coached Greg Goodley. I coached Josh's dad, Billy Bradley, and what competitors they were, and Josh is the same way. You know, if you look at what Josh has done over the years, I think he's done a tremendous job coaching the Eagles. They're always competitive. They've had some great years. They're gonna be hard to fight beat, because I know they're gonna come in here. They got some nice players. They're physical, and it's gonna be a game. So we better be prepared.
Yeah, you know, you talk about the seniors. I mentioned last night during the game, Aiden Whitlock. He's been a great player for the El Dorado Eagles, and when that game went to overtime, I told Billy, I said, I can tell you where this ball's going right here,
yeah,
right now.
Yeah.
They're going to give it to Whitlock, and they're going to say, big guy, let's see if you can get this job done, and he was able to.
Yep, I just got done, like I said, watching you guys on the Fox station, and you were perfectly right, and they cleared it out for him, and hopefully we can take that little spin move away from him, because he has a tendency to do that, so we try to find tendencies. I've probably watched three games at 12 o'clock at night on him, and he is a really good player. That sophomore is a good player. They've got some shooters. But Whitlock and Parks are the key, I think.
So, yeah.
I mean, Parker Price, so we're gonna have to be prepared to try to stop those two kids, and then hopefully none of the other ones goes nuts on us.
Yep.
So do you have your schedule pretty full for the next 2 weeks, or are you guys trying to still reschedule something, or what?
No, we've got everything. As a matter of fact, Coach Bradley had called us and saw we had an opening, and they just came down here this year because we were there last year. And
mm-hmm.
We play two next Monday, Tuesday, and then we go Friday, Saturday, Monday, Tuesday, and Saturday.
Wow.
So we'll get 15 games in this year.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Well, that's good. You know, I heard yesterday that over in Indiana, they are going to have a postseason over there. And, of course, they've been playing their games without a mask over there. And I just shake my head and think, man, you know, why couldn't we be doing that here in Illinois?
Yeah, and you know what? I think that they've come out and said when they wrestle, they don't have to have masks. I don't understand it.
Yeah.
And they're trying to say that these football kids have to play with a mask on. I mean, I don't know. It's just mind-boggling to me, but again, I am so thankful we're getting to play. And
yeah.
I think the kids have gotten used to wearing the mask, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Honestly, the kids aren't complaining too much because they just want to play, and they're thrilled to be playing.
Yeah. Yes, they are.
You know, Coach, I said last night the shame of that game last night was that it wasn't about two-thirds full with purple and green. You know how those schools go against each other.
That would have been packed. I told my kids exactly what you're talking about. I got on the bus. We fed them the sandwiches. And one of the mothers who made the sandwiches for this trip wrote them a beautiful note about not getting people getting to see them play, how they've handled adversity. And it kind of made me tear up because this group of kids is so fun to watch. And nobody's getting to watch them. They're being live streamed everywhere, and a lot of people do watch it. But it's a shame because these gyms would have been filled.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Yep.
You know, we drove through El Dorado, me and Billy, and some of our other friends. We went down to the Red Onion and eat over when the El Dorado Holiday Tournament would been going on. As we drove through town, Billy shouts out real loud in the truck, "El Dorado, I never thought I'd say this, but gosh, I miss you guys."
That's the truth. And you guys do. You guys do all the work on that El Dorado tournament, buddy. I'm going to tell you, it's amazing how I'm at that age, I can go strong for about 2 days, but you get me about that third day and I'm dragging. So mm-hmm. You guys do a great job at that. So we appreciate all you've done and what you've done over the years. So.
Well, we're always dragging on that third day,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, we are, too.
No doubt about it. Yeah, we are.
Yeah, it's a long 3 days, but it's a great experience. People that's never experienced that ought to just take a vacation day and just go down there and experience
yeah,
it.
And, you know, I'm sure hoping we have it next year.
Yeah, me too. Yep,
yeah.
Sure are.
Well, Coach, I'm glad to hear that your grandson's doing great. People need to continue praying for him and his family. And thank God for the work he's done there.
Yes, it is, and we just think he gets his MRI and his next check, and we think it's with God's grace that tumor's going to be gone.
All right. Well, Coach, we appreciate it, and best of luck tonight against the El Dorado Eagles. Thanks for your time today, all right?
Thank you, guys, and what you do. Appreciate
all right.
It.
Take care. Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.
Bye, Joe.
It's Coach Joe Hosman. Been at it for a long, long time. Meant to ask him how many years now that Joe's been at it, but yeah.
Well, I can tell you he was coaching the El Dorado Eagles in 80 and 81.
Wow, man. Yeah.
Because I'd like to ask him about some of the memories. I'd like to ask him now about some of the scouting reports and some of the things he did to me down there.
We'll get him back on and do that sometime. Yeah, sure will. Hey, when we come back, we're going to visit with Coach Doug Miller of the Hamlin County Foxes. They're going to play two games tonight, and we're also going to talk to him about that crazy, crazy night last night in El Dorado, the overtime game and the bus ride, all that kind of stuff. It's all coming up on the Sports Couch. Stay tuned. Harder Turf and Tractor is your area dealer for high-quality Kubota tractors in a variety of sizes, perfect for a landscaping business or to easily handle a variety of jobs around your home or farm. They can customize a solution for your needs. They also have the Kubota RTV utility vehicles for on-road and off-road transportation and hauling needs. When there's mowing or lawn work to be done, Harder Turf and Tractor has you covered with X-Mark riding mowers and walk-behind mowers. They also feature a good selection of Echo brand brush cutters, trimmers, and chainsaws, as well as Honda and Generac generators. Come in and see for yourself at the new Carter Turf and Tractor, open 8 to 5 Monday through Friday and 8 to 2 on Saturday.
Whether you're being cautious by staying close to home or life has just been a little too busy, you can still take advantage of the unique products and services we've designed with you in mind. You can now open and apply for a variety of checking accounts online and receive the benefits that come along with them, including high interest or cash back with a Moolah account, protection beyond your bank account with Secure Plus, online and mobile banking, and local customer and community service. Simply visit us at fnbcommunitybank.com. FNB, banking business life. Member FDIC.
It's the heating season, and Wainwright Propane and Sporting Goods remind you that they have fast, reliable propane delivery service to your home or farm. And if you need those propane bottles filled up, you can bring them to Wainwright Propane and Sporting Goods for fast service. Looking for a wide selection of guns and ammunition? You'll find it at Wainwright Propane and Sporting Goods. You can even search online through our website at wainwhitepropane.com. And don't forget, we also have hot tubs and supplies for your hot tub as well at Wainwright Propane and Sporting Goods, located on West Main Street in Fairfield. Welcome back to the Sports Couch here live on AreaSports.net. Last night in the Black Diamond Conference, a wild one down at El Dorado as Hamilton County and the El Dorado Eagles went to overtime. El Dorado won it by a score of 48-46. And right now on the Sports Couch, we want to visit with the head coach of the Hamilton County Foxes, and that's Doug Miller. Good morning, Doug. How are you?
Doing great, guys. How are you guys?
Well, we're doing fine, but I'm surprised you said you're doing great after a tough loss last night. An overtime defeat to El Dorado, one of your rivals. That had to be a difficult pill to swallow, but hey, the sun came up this morning.
Okay, I lied. I've not been very good. about 3:47 this morning, I thought, why didn't I do this? I should have done that. I mean, our coaching staff, we can critique our kids very hard. But not as hard as I could see myself after the game's over.
Yeah, well, I mean, you had quite an ordeal last night. You have power failure in McLeansboro, so the game gets moved last minute to to El Dorado, and Danny was telling me the story about how you made the phone call to Greg Goodley, the AD at El Dorado, and interrupted his supper so he could go to the gym and get it ready. But, hey, kudos to the El Dorado people for opening it up and making it happen.
Yeah, we appreciate their effort and their hard work getting that done.
Well, Coach, last night your team went down there, and it was an interesting game. It was a hard-fought battle. Both teams played pretty aggressive. I was like you at 4 o'clock this morning. I knew what you should have done last night, but I'm not going to tell you.
Yeah, thanks.
I love it.
But when I think back on the game, you know, early in that first quarter, your Foxes missed 4 real easy buckets. And, you know, when in the first quarter, people don't think a lot about that. But just one of those buckets in that first quarter that should have went or was halfway down and come out and things like that, it just takes one of those to be a victory, doesn't it?
And I told him after the game, I said, guys, this wasn't won or lost by any one individual. And it wasn't lost in the fourth quarter of the overtime. It was lost in the 36 minutes of play.
Yeah.
I go, we turned the ball over, unforced turnover, live ball turnover. They get a layup in the first quarter.
Yeah.
We missed like 6 layups. We missed 8 free throws.
Yeah.
I go, one of them possessions, and we were ahead with 20 seconds left in the game, and we turned the ball over. But we were 20 seconds away from winning that ball game.
Yeah, you know, there's a lot of would-haves, could-haves, and should-haves from last night. But one of the challenges will be for you today is, okay, how's this group going to rebound? Now, are they going to take that tough loss and build on it and come out with fire in their eyes? Or are we going to be feeling sorry for ourselves that we lost a game we probably should have won last night?
And I tell them after the game, 2 seconds, you got 2 seconds to think about this game, and it's over. And because we got to bounce back tomorrow or today and play Johnson City and then NCOE, two very athletic and good basketball teams.
You're right, Doug. I mean, it's going to be a full day of basketball, and you're going to play 3 games in less than 24 hours. And that's going to be a challenge upon itself right there.
And, I mean, and it was a different situation. We had our scouting report on the board in the locker room. We were prepared to play at home, and then they had to go to the uniform or get their uniforms in their bags and pack them and then head to El Dorado. So, I mean, that was a big adjustment for us. And that might have, you know, you never know. We missed shots that we normally make. And we missed some point-blank layups early on.
Yep.
And it's a different situation for our kids to face. But I will tell our kids this. They never quit. We were beat. We were down 4 points in regulation. And we got to stop, got to score, got to stop, got to score, and went overtime.
Yep. Yeah, I'll agree. Your kids were really resilient. I'm not sure you really got any breaks on a few calls and stuff. So, you know, it was just a hard-fought game, and it's one of those losses that you look back on after the season's over and you think, boy, all we needed to do was just get a little break here or a break there, and we escape out of there. But to get changed and do everything that you had to do at the last minute, that had to be a different atmosphere and a different outlook upon things. And I know even for us as broadcasters, we were scrambling and hurrying, and I'm sure your team was the same way. Well, the bus driver come driving into the parking lot, and she was honking the horn for the boys to get out of the truck and get on the bus because we needed to roll.
She came on 2 wheels, and she said, come on, boy, let's go.
Yeah,
2 wheels, I love it.
Yeah, so, you know, looking at today's games, you got the Johnson City Indians. That'll be about a 3 o'clock tip. What are your thoughts, sir?
Well, the Brown kid is similar to the Whitlock kid in El Dorado. He's going to demand the ball in the middle of the floor, and we got to do a better job today of leaving our man when he dribbles and cover the ball. Our game plan last night was when Whitlock dribbles the ball, our guards are going to come get him. And he got the shot off before our guards could get there. So today, we're going to get there.
Yeah.
Well, now, he did not play last night against Fairfield. He was injured late in the Carmi game, did not play last night against Fairfield. Don't know if he'll be available against you tonight.
Right. He fell on his tailbone.
Yeah, okay.
So yeah. We're going to prepare like he's going to be there.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Well, and you should. Yeah.
Well, you know, shifting gears back, you got to put your hat off to the Whitlock boy in overtime. That game, I told Billy, I said, well, I can tell you right now where the ball's going to go. It's going to go in Aiden Whitlock's hands, and he's either going to get the job done or he's not going to get the job done. And unfortunately for the Foxes, he was able to hit that big shot right there at the 5.8 seconds left in that overtime.
He's a four-year starter with a 1,000-point club, and he's a very nice player in our conference.
Yes, he is.
One of the top.
He done a nice job there last night. So,
I mean, he stepped up when he had to, and we couldn't get to him fast enough.
You know, Doug, Dave Lee always said to us, he always told me, and I've never forgot this, to be the man, you got to want to be the man. And he just took that team and strapped them on his shoulders and said, let's get this done.
He did. And I told my kids, it's okay if we lose this game tonight if you learn something from it.
Right.
And we've got to learn that. I learned myself, I did something different, but I told my kids, if we tell you that you got to get off your man and go double that kid, make somebody else beat you.
Yeah, you're right.
We talked about the last time out. Make somebody else beat us. When he dribbles the ball, guard, lead your man, and make a three-point shot from 25 foot after 35 minutes of play. God bless him.
Yeah.
Don't let him beat us.
Yeah.
And when he dribbles out, gets that ball, come and go double-team him and steal the ball. And we'll learn next time.
That's just some of the breaks. But like you said, there were so many things that happened a long time before that game ever got to that point that could have been a game changer.
Oh, it could have been a 10-point win for us or a 10-point loss for us. I mean, yeah. Both teams were back and forth, and we had momentum for a while, and we turned the ball over, and then we didn't get a couple calls in a row, and now our kids saw them calls not go our way and got their heads in a little bit. You can't do that. You just got to stay the course.
Yeah, you know, Doug, it's hard not to do that when you got a bunch of young kids. But, you know, those are the things you can't control. You got to control what's in your power, and you just got to roll with it. And you got to expect it. You know it's going to happen. You got to expect it. And but it's hard to prepare young kids for that.
It is, and they're the most physical team we play. They grinded us and bumped us and pushed us the whole game.
You know, I said that through the contest that game last night was as physical a game as you'll play all season. And your kids are not – you've got three or four kids that are just not real big on that physical aspect.
And that's got to be one selling point I have to sell before November 9th of 2021.
Yeah.
For us to take that next step.
Well, looking ahead to your NCOE game tonight, you're going to have a big Joe Melton to try to contend with there when you take on the NCOE Cardinals. So what are you going to do there?
Well, he's 6'7", and he can shoot threes. He can drive. He can penetrate. We've got a plan for him, but I won't turn on the air because I'm sure,
yeah, sure.
Gordon Johnson's listening.
Yeah,
but he'll be a handful for sure.
Oh, he's one of the top players in Southern Illinois. Comes from a good family. Paul Melton, his uncle, was on the 90 state team at North City. And his dad, Joe, played a few years later, and he's a pretty good player as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I'm sure it'll be some mixed feelings for you there tonight. You know, we coached over there for several years, had seen those kids at lower levels and stuff. But you're back home and enjoying it, doing a good job, Jug, and appreciate your efforts.
Well, thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
Doug, I know you got to go because you're going to do a little refereeing this morning of a little kids game, I guess. What's that all about?
Well, my daughter plays at NCOE today, and our coach called and said we can't find enough reasons, so we're going to cancel the game. So I said, I'll referee and I'll find somebody to do it. So my director of basketball operations, Ashley Minendorf, my new referee and partner. He said his idol is Billy Rocket, though.
Yeah. Well, what could possibly go wrong with that this morning? That sounds like fun.
Well, you can tell him that we learned to scoop down there last night. We was talking to the Eldorado coaches, and Billy walked up there, and first thing they said to him says, well, here comes old Quick Draw. And they said, what do you mean, Quick Draw? Said, he's the quickest guy on count of five you ever seen. 1, 2, 5.
Well, I'm going to hire Billy Rocket on March 13th.
I love it. That's great. Doug, we appreciate your time this morning, and good luck in both those games today, all right?
Thanks, guys. I really appreciate it.
See you after a while.
All right. Take care. Bye-bye. It's Doug Miller, head coach of the Hamilton County Foxes. And, yeah, what a weird night you guys had last night. Power goes off in McLeansboro.
What else is going to happen this season?
I mean, you tell somebody that story, they, like, don't even believe it, you know, that happened, and you all of a sudden transfer the game down to El Dorado, and you do that, I mean, on such a short notice.
Yeah, you know, it was just amazing. And that just goes to show you what kind of special people these communities have for these kids.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Doug Miller made the call to the transportation director. She called her mother-in-law and said, hey, can you bring the bus? We need to go to El Dorado. And she said, I'm on my way. You called the El Dorado, get Greg Goodley and his family's getting ready to have supper. He puts his food in a box to go.
Yeah.
And says, leave the ticket for my wife. She'll pay. And he picks up and he calls his Jeff Miner and the other man that works with him down there on the scores table and gets them there.
Mm-hmm.
Doug Miller calls Dana Pearson and said, hey, you guys need to change directions. You need to go to El Dorado instead of coming to Hamilton County. And they said, well, thanks for the quick notice, and said, well, call Marion SIP Power Company and tell them they're the ones responsible for this fiasco tonight.
I'll tell you what, that's a lot of logistics to turn around and do it in such a short period of time and to pull that off. But you're right. I mean, everybody realizes how important it is to allow the kids to play right now. It's a short season the way it is, and you didn't want to have to miss that game last night and then try to find a way to reschedule it because the schedule is pretty packed the next couple of weeks.
Everybody's full, and if you've not got your game scheduled to be made up now, it's not going to happen because there's no officiating crews available.
Yeah.
And
it's pretty tough.
It's tough.
Although I will say this, Mount Vernon is still looking for another game. So if anybody listening has got a date available, your team is available for either Tuesday, March 2nd or Saturday, March 6th. The Mount Vernon Rams are still looking for an opponent, home or away. So that's Tuesday, March 2nd. Or Saturday, March 6th, they're looking for an opponent to play. But again, there's a lot of people that they would like to play, but you can't go so far out of the region because of this IDPH guidelines. Otherwise, they would have been scheduling Effingham or
well, they already had Breeze Modern Day on the schedule and had to cancel them.
Had to take that one off, had to take Lawrenceville off.
They're out of their region.
Yeah, and that would have been a great game with Breeze Modern Day.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, because they had a big win last night over Granite City. So, but again, you can't do it. Well, the Olney Tigers have been having a good season. They ran up against a very tough Casey Westfield team last night. They fell 54-37. But Coach Rob Flanagan, I'm sure, is like every other coach, just glad to be playing some basketball. And he joins us on the sports couch right now. Good morning, Rob. How are you?
Guys, how are you?
Great.
Thanks for having me.
You bet. Good to have you on the show. Yeah, I mean, I'm sure you didn't think we were going to be playing basketball. I know your son had went over to start playing in Indiana, and it's just one of those things that all of a sudden, we are playing, but we're glad to be playing, aren't we?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we were sitting here, and I always tell people, I think proximity of where we lived allowed us to move over to Sullivan, you know, for Braden. And that was just a thing where I just felt like it was a decision I had to make as a dad.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly, it wasn't a decision you made as a coach because you take one of your best players away and give him to somebody else.
Right.
But it has been a super experience. The people at Sullivan have been fantastic for us, and I've got a little Hoosier living here in the last few months.
Yeah.
And a lot of road time going back and forth to my job here at Olney, and have a special group of kids that Braden played with here at Olney that we're really happy for them that they get to play this particular year. We knew it could happen when we did that, and hey, you just got to man up and handle it. And I've been real proud of my son. He has been a man through all this and handled it. I just can't say enough about how he's handled it and how well he's played and the experience that we've had with it.
Well, that's good. So things are going well for him at Sullivan. They're still having some success there?
Yeah, they were ranked number 8 in 3A. They had won 10 in a row, played the number 4, I think, ranked team in 1A, and over there, boy, I tell you, the 1A teams, 2A teams, they just go at each other hard. There's not a huge disparity. They played North Davies last night and got beat on a 35-foot bank three-point shot at the buzzer.
49-48.
And there was a big crowd. They had, you know, they've opened up attendance for the sectional and stuff over there, so the postseason starts Tuesday, and that's really, really exciting for him. But they're 18-3. it's been a phenomenal year for them. Kids have really blended together as a good team and have welcomed him with open arms.
Well, we're happy for Braden because, again, he's got to play 21 games over there in Indiana at Sullivan and play without a mask, and now they're going to have postseason over there, which we're not going to have in Illinois.
Yeah, it's it was definitely one of those things where when we opened up here, we just kind of sat down and just kind of said, hey, we've got to show our toughness. And I think we've got to show our respect for the game because it's emotional to not have him with you. You want to coach your son, and we've traveled a lot of miles together, but at the same time, respect for the game. I mean, you can't have it both ways.
Mm-hmm.
It's the old have your cake and eat it too type thing. If you're going to go over there, it's great when you think we're not playing here. But when we open up and now the team that you were supposed to be with is playing, and he's just done a really, really good job of staying focused on what his job is over there. I feel like we've got our guys off to a really good start. We have an extremely young team with no seniors, and you take your point guard and your leader and an all-South player out of your lineup. And for us to get – and we got our ears pinned back a little bit last night. We got physically kind of manhandled last night by a really good KZ team. And but we lost our other game by 1 point. And it's just kind of been – it's kind of went along with what the year's been like.
Mm-hmm.
Every day is – you just got to handle literally every day. And I know all of us kind of thought sometimes – you're handling it hour to hour through all of this stuff, and especially here in the fall with knowing whether or not you were going to play or not. But our other loss was to Marshall, who's pretty good as well, and I thought we really played well in that game. We had a 1-on-1 free throw opportunity with 2.7 seconds left, and we missed it. We have a sophomore at the line, big kid, missed it. But ironically, Wednesday night up at Paris, that same kid turns around and hit 2 free throws to seal the game for us. So, you're going to have that, I think, with some young kids, predominantly young kids. So we feel like we've been off to a pretty good start here.
Well, I was going to say, you've got one, you said you don't have seniors, but you got one guy that you're really building around that we were so impressed with last year as a sophomore, and that's Chase Travis. I've got a picture of him on the screen right now, and he really is one of the best players in Southern Illinois.
Yeah, he is, and he had a little bit of a rough night last night. I'll be honest with you. He I think he misses Braden at times, just because they were so good together last year. But yeah, Chase is. I mean, gosh, he is, and vice versa. Braden misses playing with him as well. And they traveled the AAU circuit for Justin Barrington's Illinois Bears this summer. And had a phenomenal summer. And, those guys wanted to play together. And I think the respect that they have for each other and that all of our kids, and I think the people around Southern Illinois have for Chase, is, he's a top-notch player. There's no doubt about it. He can do a little bit of everything. Certainly has he has some parts of his game that's exciting that he can get better at, that he can put time in and get better at like everybody does. But he's also a polished player at the same time. And he's going to make someone a good player at the next level for sure.
Well, Coach, that's the importance of these kids getting at least the opportunity we got, irregardless of how havoc and hard things have been to get done. There for a long time, it looked like this season was going to be null and void. And for young kids to miss out a whole year of basketball, it would have had major ramifications.
Yeah, it's you just got to deal with with so much of the situation. I'm not a settle for it guy. I'll settle for this or settle for that. But some of this stuff has almost forced you to be like that, and you have to, For example, we lose last night, and you really can't dwell on it because now you're going to Robinson tonight in a makeup game.
And
life is kind of unforgiving sometimes, and I'm talking about the big picture but also the smaller picture of your basketball season. Hey, we'd all like to play Tuesday, Friday, Saturday, maybe have prep.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not going to be the case now, and you better put the you know, the last game behind you, whether it's a win or a loss, and hopefully you got some good out of the experience and can build on some things. You got to get ready for the next one. And I know that's the case with us, and that's the case with everybody in the state of Illinois right now.
Yeah, you know, just to give you an example, the Hamilton County Foxes was supposed to have a home game last night against El Dorado, and about an hour before game time, the city of McLeansboro goes black. It loses all power. So
I heard you guys talking about that as I waited on the phone. That was, I did not know that.
Yeah.
I didn't see the score of the game. That just shows you right there what people are willing to do to play and to get these games in. I mean, it's that's a phenomenal score. That's one for the books, definitely.
That's what I said. I said one thing about it. I told my partner Billy Rocket last night. I said one thing about it. We will not forget 2021. There's no way. The things we've done here a while back, our schedule changed three times. And like you said, about a three-hour period, just so they could get some games in, and we've just flew by the seat of our pants all season.
Yeah, it's one of those things where you don't, you know, they always say, but a person can do a lot. They do a lot more than what they think they can, and you know, everybody likes their comfort zone to be what they want it to be. But then when you're taken out of it, you realize that, hey, we're probably capable of handling a lot more than what do they say? God won't put on you more than what you can handle.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. We've all had to handle a lot of things this year. And, you know, kind of to that point, I'd be remiss if I didn't take a minute and just – I texted with him earlier this week and just wish the Holloway family the very best. I know – Coach Holloway, Tim and I go way back. We were neighbors, old McClellan grade school guys. I know Tim lost his mom,
right?
Martha, this week, and Gary was friends with my family and my dad. And Gary and I are friends. Tim's dad, and we just, I know my family and myself in particular, our heart goes out to them. And Marcia was always really good to me, and we wanted to just wish them the best and know that they're in our prayers.
Yeah, she's a sweet lady and definitely going to be missed by everyone.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's right. You have made some changes up there at Olney East Richland High School. You guys have done a lot of remodeling of your gym, and I think you've added an auxiliary gym, and I guess that's all completed now, huh?
Yeah, and you know, if you guys are ever going to do any remodeling, I think the best time to do it is during a full-on pandemic. That just adds to the fun. That just cuts your stress level in half.
Yeah, I'm sure it does.
Yeah, it just cuts it in half to know you got. But yeah, we have. We've done a bunch of improvements. You guys are gonna laugh when I say this. I actually walked down into the science wing of our building yesterday for really the first time here in 2021.
Wow.
I've been around a lot of parts of the building, but I haven't been down in our science wing. And it's really nice. And the whole school is. There's a lot of improvements. Now, it's like anything else. You'd always like to have, I wish we would have done this or I wish we would have done that. But it has definitely a different feel to it. We've been able to keep the feel of Ron Heron Gym. And we're still putting Humpty Dumpty back together again. In there. We had to remove a lot of our stuff from the Hall of Fame just because of construction dust stuff like that. So you know, when you move out and you remodel, one of the least fun things is moving the stuff back in.
Mm-hmm.
So we're kind of in between that, but yet we're able to get our games in. And then we've got I've labeled it and it's kind of stuck. I just call our auxiliary gym Ron Heron Jr. So everybody just calls it. We just call it Junior.
I love that. That's great.
You're practicing in Junior or your PE classes in Junior.
I love that. That's great.
I know Ron Heron would smile. I know him a little.
Yes, he would.
Yeah, he's smiling down on you, Rob.
That's hilarious.
Yeah,
that's great.
So we've been able to. We had a game. We had a fresh with the games backed up. We had a girls and boys kind of a doubleheader with Marshall the other night, and we played them in junior.
Mm-hmm.
And it was nice. So we christened it with a win, and it's going to be a really good facility for a lot of things, and I think you could probably look for us to be doing some shootouts and some other things in the summer.
Well, that's awesome.
And it's one of those things where you can, you know, I think you can make some money off of it with those things, and it can then lead to other things that you can do for your program.
Yeah, well, that's excellent. I'm glad you guys were able to get that completed. And like you say, doing that during a pandemic, that's a monumental job.
What else would you want to deal with, you know?
If you want to have a sports couch special, you can bring me on and I can talk for an hour just about some of the stories we have from the,
I'm sure that you could.
From the pandemic and the construction project.
I'm sure you could. That's right. Wow, that's a great story there, Rob. Well, hey, you know, we're going to be making this transition into football here in just a couple of weeks, and there's going to be a little overlap there. And how many of your basketball players also try to play football there at Olney?
I got a couple guys, and they're both young, and they're sophomores. And they're good, tough kids. So, you know, they're doing a little bit of, I think they'll handle the overlap. And like I told them, like Coach Music, our football coach, told them, hey, it's a weird year. What other choice do you have?
Yeah.
You know, you just have to handle it. I always worry, and I'm not saying about our guys, but just in general, I just worry about injury. You know, I think you're training muscles to get ready for football in August, July and August.
Yeah.
And then when you get done with that, you know, that kids come in, you're like, oh, you got to get the football out of them. And then they kind of slide into basketball mode after a few weeks. And then it's getting your arm in shape and getting your swing down if you're a baseball player, or different muscles you use in track. And I don't know when the time is for those things to adapt now. I mean, you're going to roll right into all those things. And I'm not a nervous Nelly about those things. Kids are pretty resilient, but I do worry a little bit about injuries. I know as a player myself, I think my son's like this too. Loves baseball, but when he's in basketball, he's in basketball. But it takes him a while. Some guys can flip the switch and just roll right out there. I think it takes him a little bit to kind of get in the baseball mode. Or if he's in baseball and been playing baseball, it kind of takes him a little bit to get in the basketball mode. I don't know how these kids will respond that are, you know, 2 and 3 sport athletes to this, but I know this, they'll have to respond quickly one way or another.
Yeah, they're not going to have any choice. They're going to have to respond.
Yeah, I think a lot of this if you guys have seen, and guys that play and parents and coaches all know what I'm talking about. Everything now to me has just such an AAU
feel to it,
travel ball type feel to it.
Yeah.
Like I'll call you and I'll go, you know, just like your game with El Dorado and McLeansboro. Yeah. I'll call you and I'll go, hey, what are you doing Saturday? Why don't we get our teams together? I'll get some umpires and we'll go out here to the field.
Yeah.
And why don't we play at 1:00? I mean, and that's not what I think of as high school basketball. I think people know schedule. People know the times. People know traditions. People know when you play. People know what tournament. And now it's just kind of, and it has to be like that. It's kind of a free for all, just to jam some games in. And like you said, we're all happy to have that, but it is certainly different and strange and hurried and rushed. I think at times, I think if you've got a veteran group, it might be a little bit easier, maybe. But I'm not blessed with that, so I'm pretty pleased with where we are right now with what we've done.
Yeah, and then Mother Nature throws in a week of snow out in the middle of all this. Yeah,
as big a storm as we've had in quite some time.
Right, yeah, yeah. It's been something.
Yeah, and I just think that it's just been a crazy time. I mean, I just think people could go stir crazy over this. It can get you down, man.
It can,
but
it can.
You got to keep on keeping on.
But if we weren't playing at all, we'd really be down too. So
no doubt about it.
We got to take what we got. Yeah. Hey, Rob.
Are we ever happy?
No, that's right. That's right. Rob, we appreciate your time this morning. Really enjoyed it. And continued best of luck to Braden as he continues on over there at Sullivan. Hope they can make some noise in postseason over there as well. And
absolutely. They're in a tough sectional. They will start Tuesday night with Washington at Washington, and then if fortunate enough to win that one, they'll have Princeton, and then Pike Central, Vincent, Lincoln, winner. So it's Tuesday, Friday, Saturday for them. Not a good draw, but they got a good club.
Yeah, and best of luck to your Tigers tonight as you take on Robinson, right?
Yep, absolutely. We're going to go have a little walk through here in a little bit and jump back on the bus.
You going to do that in the junior?
We will probably let Ron Heron have this one today. We'll be in the original.
Okay. All right. Hey, take care. Have a great weekend. Thank you. All right.
Thanks for having me.
You bet. All right, Rob. Bye-bye. Rob Flanagan, head basketball coach there at Olney, and always fun to talk to. And, I love that. It named their auxiliary GM Junior, Ron Heron Jr.
I tell you what, he's a great guy. Yeah, he's a real good guy to talk with. And he was just up front about his son.
Absolutely.
He didn't shy away from that.
Can't blame him for doing what he did. And look, Braden's got to play 21 games over there so far, and season's still going. And they're going to play postseason, and he's playing without a mask.
And,
he's
enhanced his opportunity to go to the next level.
I have to agree with what he's done. If I was in the same position, I very well might have done exactly the same thing.
Me too.
You know? So, hey, when we come back, we're going to talk to Coach Andy Fehrenbacher of the Salem Wildcats. Talk about some Cahokia Conference basketball action. All that and more on the Sports Couch when we come back here on AreaSports.net. Here's great news for dog lovers. Jagger's Doggy Daycare has expanded their dog grooming department with three highly skilled groomers who have a combined 30 years of dog grooming experience. If your dog needs a haircut, a trim, a shave down, a de-shed bath, or a bath and brush out, Jagger's Doggy Daycare has you covered. They now offer dog grooming services 7 days a week. Plus, they are your one-stop shop for dog boarding, dog training, and doggy daycare. That's Jagger's Doggy Daycare, 414 Main Street in Mount Vernon. Call for an appointment today at 316-7021.
With the housing market picking up and rates so low, now is the perfect time to purchase the home of your dreams. Hi, this is Sarah Moult, mortgage originator from People's National Bank. As your home for home loans, People's National Bank has personal service and quick turnarounds to help you get in the home of your dreams. Stop by and see me, Sarah Moult, or apply online at peoplesnationalbank.com today. People's National Bank, your home for home loans. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender. Loan subject to credit approval.
Sometimes you need an attorney who can look out for your interest. Located just a short drive away in Mount Vernon, Olson and Reeves offer a free consultation to discuss your needs. Everything is discreet and confidential. At Olson and Reeves, they can provide you with consultation and assistance with traffic law and DUIs, estate planning, living wills, divorce, real estate contracts, personal injury and accidents, as well as medical malpractice. Call Olson and Reeves Attorneys at Law in Mount Vernon at 316-7322.
Welcome back to the Sports Couch here on a Saturday morning. I'm Randy Olson along with Danny Anselment. Going to shift gears here and talk a little bit about the Cahokia Conference basketball action. Salem Wildcats coach Andy Fehrenbacher joins us on the line. Good morning, Andy. How you doing?
I'm doing great. How you doing, Randy?
Oh, just fine. We had you on the show a few weeks ago, and of course, we've all been lamenting all the weird things that have been going on, you know, with trying to play basketball this year. And, of course, you've probably heard us talk about the weird story last night where they had to move the Hamilton County El Dorado game to El Dorado at the last minute because power went out in McLeansboro. And, you know, all the snow comes in. We're trying to scramble to reschedule games. We're seeing people play on Monday nights and Wednesday nights in some really weird time. It's just it's strange, but at least we're playing basketball.
Yeah, it is. It's a very odd season, unlike any that I've been a part of for my 23 years at this point. And you just kind of have to kind of roll with it and adjust and adapt. That just goes with the education field in general. So,
yeah.
You know, it is what it is.
Yeah, well, we just had Coach Rob Flanagan on from Olney, and you're good friends with Rob, too. You know each other well. And he said it best, I think. He said, I'm glad we're playing and everything, but he says, we got to be honest with each other. He said, this whole thing kind of has an AAU feel to it.
It does, because it's more about, you know, people just trying to play games whenever and wherever they can and just try to cram as many games in as they can.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I some people may like that. To be honest with you, me as I've been around now for a little while. I really enjoy practice. I enjoy the preparation and teaching and those types of aspects of coaching. And we just don't get very much time to do that right now.
No, and so I think Coach Flanagan's in the same camp with you there on that.
I think every coach is in the same camp.
Joe Hosman said that this morning, too.
Yeah, I said, you know, there's no time to correct problems from the game before to make yourself better. It's just, okay, hey, let's regroup and see what we can get done tonight.
Yeah, it is. You don't have much time. And the time that you do have, I mean, you know, sharing gym space and things like that, because everybody is trying to get in. And I mean, for basketball, boys and girls are playing right now. But, however, football starts up this next week. Soccer, you know, baseball, softball in a few weeks. I mean, everybody's trying to, you know, to use facilities. And I get it. We're all sharing kids, and I get that, too. And I think at Salem High School, we're working very well together, all the coaches. But it makes it very difficult. It really, really does. So we're just trying to keep a positive attitude, just trying to keep things kind of loose and light, and knowing that there's going to be some mistakes, knowing that there's going to be some things that you wish you could do a little differently. You just don't have the time to fix it. You really don't. So you just have to kind of roll with it.
Well, I know you got a win earlier in the week against Freeburg, but I actually don't even have your score in front of me last night. So tell me about your Wildcats last night.
We did not play last night.
Okay. That's why I don't have a score.
That's right. With the Cahokia, the way our athletic director set it up for this shortened season, we were playing our conference games on either a Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday type rotation.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, you could pick up out of conference game if you wanted to on one of the other nights. Some people have, some haven't, you know, so – yeah, we played at Central on Tuesday. We were home against Freeburg Thursday, and then we have Columbia this afternoon.
Yeah,
so we were pretty busy the way it was.
Oh, that is pretty busy. So it's an afternoon game today against Columbia.
It is, yep. Yeah, we have the press off at 11, JV 12:30, and then varsity at 2.
Yeah, yeah. And there's a lot of teams, of course, that are doing the triple header thing. And, of course, that helps out with the bus transportation and all that as well. And it also gives you as a varsity coach a chance to – maybe spend a little bit more time watching your freshman play that you might otherwise not be able to do.
Yeah, oh, yeah, absolutely, because there's times in a regular season when they're on the road and we have practice and I just can't get to it. Obviously, if they're at home, I can. But then, you know, also I have my own kids. And, I mean, my son's in high school, but my daughter's in junior high and trying to get to her stuff whenever. So it makes it tough, but you just work it out. But yeah, I mean, that's one thing with the triple header. It's worked out fairly well.
Mm-hmm. Well, tell us about your two games this week. You lost to Brees Central on Tuesday, I guess it was, and then Thursday you got the win against Freeburg. So tell us a little bit about those games.
Well, both quality opponents, very well coached, and we went over to Central on Tuesday. And I tell you what, the final score, it doesn't tell how that game went, actually. It was back and forth in the first half. We were down, I think, 20-15 at halftime. But then in the third quarter, kind of nip and tuck. We got a little closer. We actually, with about a minute and a half to go in the quarter, we were down two and had a shot to tie, and we missed. And they came down, got an and one, so they went up five. We turned it over. They got another bucket, so now we're down seven. And then we were trying to hold for the last shot. Had a miscommunication there. They had it with a few seconds, and off a broken play hit a three. That all of a sudden now you're, instead of only being down two with a chance to tie, you're down 10. And it snowballed real fast. And then in the fourth quarter, they kind of held it at double digits. You know, we had to then get out and kind of, you know, try to make something happen. And they burned us a few times for some layups, and they hit free throws. And we didn't get a shot from the field. We made some free throws, but that's why it ended up being a little bit bigger margin, a deficit than what it really was all game. So, Central's a really good team, and but we get a chance to play them again in 2 weeks or a week and a half, so we'll look forward to that. But then we turned the page and had a good practice on Wednesday, actually, and came out against a quality Freeburg team that beat us 2 weeks ago at their place, and we played our most complete game, 32-minute from tip to the final buzzer, played great, and got a big, big win.
Well, that's good. That's really something to build upon then.
Yeah, it is. And I mean, that's just one of those things, and that's what I told the kids. As frustrating as it was that the one with Central kind of got away from us, you know, we didn't have time to worry about it. We just had to regroup and push forward that next day. And like I said, had a great practice, just turned the page and move on. And like I said, we played great on Thursday night, so we're hoping to just keep that momentum going into today.
Well, you know, Andy, that's what I talked with Doug Miller this morning. I said I'm going to be interested to see what his Foxes do today. They had that tough loss last night where that thing got completely turned upside down by changing venues and everything else.
Yeah.
And then to get beaten overtime. So now, like you said, you don't have no time to practice, get ready. They got a 3 o'clock tip this afternoon against the Johnson City team, and then they're going to turn around and play NCOE at 8 o'clock tonight. So it's going to be interesting to see how his team responds from that tough loss. Are they going to learn something from that, come out with fire in their eyes, or are they still going to be feeling sorry for themselves? So, you know, it'll be a big challenge, and it's every team is facing that right now.
Oh, that's absolutely correct. And you know, right now is the time, and I've preached this to our kids the last few weeks. I said, there's just no time. You can't feel sorry for yourself. Hey, we've had three tough losses. We have five losses, and three of them was by a total combined of like 9 points.
I mean,
we lost by 2, 3, and 4 to quality teams in Fairfield, Mount Carmel, and Columbia earlier. Those were all close games. We had chances. We just couldn't get over the hump. But it is what it is. You got to move forward. You can't worry about it. Just turn the page, come out ready to play that next one. That's really all you can do right now.
Yeah,
you know but the side effect of that is we're so fortunate these kids aren't missing out on a complete season and then coming into the gym next November and trying to regroup and get restarted. At least we've got something here that they are getting the opportunity to play and try to get better and make themselves better. But also, look at the life lessons these kids are being taught right now. I mean, you know, this is sometimes in life, you're going to get things thrown at you like this, and these kids are going to be prepared for that.
Yeah, and we've talked about that, too, with our kids. And I said, you know, it is. It's exactly how life works. There's things happen that's out of your control that you can't do anything about. And you have, you know, two ways you can look at it. You can get down and feel sorry for yourself, or you just pick yourself up and meet the challenge and just push through and do the best you can. Yeah, it's not ideal, and it's not what you want, but very rarely in life do things work out that way. So, you know, you just have to roll with it and try to make the best of of the situation. And, you know, it's great that our seniors are getting a chance to be together and play on their home floors and that kind of stuff and compete together for the last time. But also for the younger kids, at least it's something for building blocks that hopefully we get some kind of an off season so that for next season, you know, it can be better and working our way back to some kind of normalcy. So it is. I think as coaches, you just have to step up, be positive leaders, and try to spin it in a way that you look at those things. And I know I'm as bad as any coach is. The losses hurt. They get me down, and I get upset about it, and I have sleepless nights and all kinds of stuff. But really right now, you got to kind of take it into perspective a little bit.
Yeah.
And I've tried to have a little bit different attitude than I normally would with seasons. And it's taught me some things too.
Yeah, I think we've all been learning a lot through this.
Yeah, we've all learned, Andy.
We sure have.
You know, guys got to be able to make adjustments. Life's about making adjustments. And unfortunately, everybody in this United States has had to make adjustments this year.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. It is. And, you know, we could spend hours and hours and hours talking about how it could have been handled a little differently and done better and this and that.
Yep.
But there's just no time for that right now.
No.
As I said, we just got to be positive. We just got to, you know, keep teaching the kids and pushing them in the right direction and say, hey, you know, this is what it is for right now. Let's make the most of it. Let's work together. Let's have a little bit of fun and let's compete at a high level and just try to do the best we can.
Yeah. What time are you tipping off this afternoon against Columbia?
Well, we have a fresh off with them at 11, JV at 12:30, and then varsity's at 2.
Is that a BE Gum gym today?
Yep.
Okay.
We went to Columbia 2 weeks ago, so they get to make the road trip here today. So, we're looking forward, though, to getting back on the floor and getting after it again.
Yeah.
Like I said, we had a good game Thursday night. Kids were loose and upbeat last night at practice. We just just had a short, sweet hour and a half practice and got in and out. And, let's be ready to lace them up and play hard.
Yeah. All right. Well, we appreciate your time today, Andy, as always. And take care and good luck today in your games against Columbia. All right.
Thanks a lot. I appreciate you having me on, Randy.
No problem.
Have a good day, and I hope we talk to you again down the road.
All right. Enjoy the weekend.
See
Thank you. Bye-bye. Andy Fehrenbacher, head coach of the Salem Wildcats, triple header today against Columbia. And, again, trying to make adjustments and just trying to make the most of it. And that's all we all can do, and that's all these coaches can do in this situation.
That's all you can do, Randy. There ain't no other way. I mean, you just got to deal with it. It's not been that long ago. If you would have asked me, I'd have told you, well, this season's over. There's not a chance of anything happening here. And, fortunately, we're going to get to have about 15 to 18 games by most of these teams. So, as my grandpa once told me, he said, son, you need to always remember, some is better than none, and that's kind of where we're at right here. What we're getting is definitely better than none because we experienced the none for the first 3 months of the basketball season.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yep.
It's just one of those deals. Everybody's rolling with the flow.
That's right. That's all you can do. And on the phone with us right now is another coach who's been at this game for a long, long time. He's coached several different stops and had a lot of different teams and different circumstances. But, hey, it's the first time he's ever coached in a pandemic as well. That's Wendell Wheeler, the head coach of the Cobden Apple Knockers. They're still unbeaten on the season and clearly one of the best 1A schools in all of Southern Illinois. And we're glad to have him on the Sports Couch this morning. Good morning, Coach Wheeler.
Hey, good morning. Thank you for having me.
You bet. Good to have you on the show. And, you've got yourself quite a basketball team down there this year in those Cobden Apple Knockers. Tell us about it.
We've got a good group of boys, and we've had a real good the first 2 years. I had some great kids that helped really help us build the program we wanted, and these guys are kind of getting benefit of the hard work those guys that came before them put in. And so we're pretty happy with the culture we've got and the way we're building. As anybody tell you, to be an apple knocker, apple knockers are known for having pretty good size, and we're awfully big this year.
Yeah, you really are big. And everybody remembers the story of the Cobden apple knockers from way back in the 50s or whatever it was, and that special team that they had. And that was back in the one class system, of course. And many people are saying, this might be the best Cobden Apple Knockers team since those days. And unfortunately, you're not going to get to play postseason this year. But just like everybody else, you're trying to make the most of it and doing all you can. And so far, it's been unblemished.
Well, I'll tell you, we returned two starters from last year's team. Noah Franklin is a senior, and his younger brother Tyler started last year as a freshman. And but after that, we lost five of our top seven players coming into the year. So, we knew we had a lot of holes to fill, a lot of good guys to replace. So I think it goes to show the work and how hard these guys have got after it and the improvement that they've made to get us where we're at right now.
Mm-hmm. Have you had any trouble scheduling games? Are you guys still looking for some games, or how's that been?
I tell you, everything's been shotgunned on that pretty good. We try to get games that we could. Our conference is a little bit bigger. We've got nine schools in our conference, and our conference went to home and away schedule. So that gave us 16 off the bat, which was pretty good. We tried to get, some other games. We're going up to Patoka next weekend, and that was a selfish game on my part. That's where I started coaching, and
mm-hmm.
I know I don't have long left, and I really would like to coach up in that gym again and be around those folks. And we're going to end the year at Trico, who got up with early. But after that, we really had some trouble because there's not a lot of days.
Yeah.
We had a game with Massac County that got snowed out, during that thing. So we went 2 weeks without playing.
Wow.
Now, we really, coming up the last 2 weeks of the season, we have no time. We've got actually six games next week because we play twice on next Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
We got four the next. So we've got 10 games in 2 weeks. We really, we don't have an open date. But, and again, you know, before the season, you're talking to a team that, you know, loses five of their top seven. You know, you didn't expect to be where we're at right now, but very happy to be there, though.
Sure, sure. Well, you mentioned some of your players and some of your returners and stuff like that. Go ahead and run through some of the rest of your roster, too, because some of the people in our area may not be familiar with the Apple Knockers. So go ahead and talk about your guys and brag on them a little bit here.
Well, you know, we're led by Noah Franklin. He's a 6'7 senior. He signed, he's going to Southwest Baptist University to play basketball next year. He's a four-year starter and has had a great, great career. He got All-State honors last year. And, you know, has just had a great career, a great young man. All the coaches in Southern Illinois, I really tell you, there's kids in the senior class you really feel bad for, because basically they're only getting to play half a season.
Mm-hmm.
And he's kind of that's a perfect example of that. He's closing in personal goals. He's closing in our school record, scoring record. He's right there, at a shot at 2,000 career points. And
wow,
you know, that when a regular season he would have got those fairly easy, but now it's it's kind of a toss up for him. But you kind of like that for your kids, and so, but he, you know, that doesn't bother him. And he's also our leader in assists. A lot of the time we play him at the point. Not many schools play a 6'7" point guard, and no 1A schools play 6'7" point guard.
Right. Well, that's got to be a matchup problem for the other team, I'm sure.
Yeah, he's our best. He's our best ball handler, so we put a lot on him, and he has really done a great job of leading for us. Other returning starter is his younger brother, not smaller brother, but younger brother, Tyler. Tyler's 6'6", shooter. We play him in and out. Early in the week, we had a big win down at Meridian. He had 29 when Noel got in foul trouble. So he's really coming on. And again, he's just a sophomore. Our other starters are we start two seniors, and Sippy Samora. He's a regular point guard. He's a 5'10 kid and didn't get any varsity time last year. Solid JV guy and has really improved. And we're getting everything we can out of him. And the same with John Eck, who's done a great job in that role player, that kind of a glue guy, screener, defensively done a good job. And he's right there, 6'2", 6'2 and a half. So, you know, we got pretty good size all around. And then our post guy, we have Elliot Lowndes, who is a 6'10 junior. And Elliot is just
Cobden.
Early what, last summer.
Is it the apples down there or what?
Well, you know, you got to.
We need something in Hamilton County. Let us in on the secret.
Yeah. Well, you know, apples are up there pretty high, and you got to get up there and reach for them.
That's the secret.
Yeah. We've every game somebody's asked, we've told him we put salt in his shoes, and we've. But he came to Cobden early last summer, and he was about 6'7", and he's just still growing. But he's legit 6'10", but he's got nice hands. Shoots the ball well from 15. He's gone, gets it up and down the floors, hit a three, a couple threes for us. So we use him to help against pressure.
Mm-hmm.
We get pressed. So he's got a really, you know, he's a 16-year-old kid, and he's got a really bright future if he wants to go that route.
Yeah.
So that gives us. But again, he's a kid that wasn't. I don't think anybody ever noticed before. You know, he was one of those 6'2", eighth graders.
Mm-hmm.
Kind of, you know, that'd be about 6'3", 6'4", when he got to high school. And he's long and lanky. There's not a, you know, we try to get him to eat more. One of those things. But
uh-huh.
he's got nice hands and passes as well. And, man, you combine him with a Franklin. So we go 6'6", 6'7", 6'10", across our front line.
Wow, that's just incredible.
Yeah, we cut off a lot of passing lanes. And, we keep trying to talk to him. Like, you just don't want to be the tall kid. You want to be a good basketball player. And that's what we really spend time. Like even Elliot at 6'10", or most of the time, like a kid like Noah Franklin at 6'7", he's just a block-to-block, post-up type of bit. And like I said, he's our best ball handler, and that's really, really helping us as far as trying to get the things done we need during the game.
Yeah, it creates some awful tough matchups because most kids that you're going to either guard him with is about 5'10 or 6 foot. Mm-hmm. And then he can take them to the box and post them up. I'm right. Sure that creates a lot of havoc.
Yeah, it. I tell you what, we can get you, we get zones mostly. But we get Lowndes and Noah into that high-low. That's a pretty tough deal to defend. And we know we're lucky to have that.
Sure.
But they worked hard on that. And I think, too, that a lot of credit, they play so hard for us. I mean, they get out, they're running the floor. Our transition offense has been very helpful, the way we can get out and run. And we got a couple of guys we're bringing off the bench. Got a young man named Brock Reynolds is our perimeter sub. He's a 6 foot junior, and he's our JV point guard, and he'll come in and help spell us on the perimeter. And then we've got our backup, I guess you would call him center, but the guy we run in for Elliott Lowndes, Edwin Funes. Now we list him at 6'1", but he is really closer to about 5'10", 5'11". But I told him there's no way I'm gonna sub a 5'10 guy for a 6'10 guy, so you're 6'1 right now.
I love that.
I'm not going to do that, Edwin.
That's
but he's
great.
One of those. He's like you're talking about, he's that classic 1A post guy. He's got great strength, a lot of weight room, good footwork. You know, we've all seen that small, undersized post guy at the lower levels that just does a great job of posting and signaling and screening. And so whenever, like, Lowndes needs a break, Edwin's in for him. But, again, we don't lose anything because we still got 6'7", 6'6", in there with him.
Yeah.
Those guys, and you know, it says a lot for high school kids. They know my job is go in, let my guy catch his breath, and when he's ready, he's back for me. But I'm going to come in and give you what I got. There's no pouting about, why don't I do this or more. So that type of stuff is I think that's your program and your culture, and that's what's really helping us have success this year.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, I'm so glad we're playing basketball, but boy, I hate the fact that with the kind of team that you've got this year and the size you've got, I hate the fact that there's not a postseason this year, so you could see how far the Apple Knockers could go, because I think you got a special team down there, and I'm assuming that in all the years that you've coached basketball, Coach Wheeler, you've never had a 6'10 player before, right, let alone a 6'7 point guard.
Like I said, they just, and to have the skill level and the work ethic that they put in to improve.
Mm-hmm.
Like I said, when Elliott early, you wouldn't have gave it a second thought. He looked, you would thought, well, that looked good in the team picture.
Mm-hmm.
But man, he's come on and he's meshed so well with like the Franklin brothers and Ekins and Mora. So that's that helped. It's what a great piece to any puzzle. But they've really played well together.
Yeah, that's great. You mentioned next week you're playing at Patoka. That's the closest that you are to us. We'd love to see you play. What day and time is that happening?
We are playing Saturday afternoon. I think our JV is going to start like at 2:00.
Okay.
And the varsity will be right after that.
Yeah, next Saturday. Okay. All right. We're going to check our schedule on that and see exactly where we're going to be. We would certainly love to see you play. But you said your schedule is full the next 2 weeks, so you don't have any other openings, right?
No. Like on that Saturday, we actually have we play at 10 in the morning against Agape Christian out of our conference.
Uh-huh.
And it would be kind of a big game. They've only had one loss this year.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that game, we'll get on the bus and head up to Patoka.
Wow.
But that 2 weeks of the ice and then the snow just destroyed our schedule.
Yeah, no, I understand.
Our athletic director, Justin Engelman, we've been looking, all year we were trying to, get games here or there. And, but just, we had to, like I said, we had the Massac County game, would have been a great game.
Oh, would have been a great game, yeah.
But that, that was right in the middle of the ice and the snow. And, so we lost that. But Justin's done a great job of not losing any of our original 18. He's been able to reschedule everything we lost other than that Massac one.
Got it.
So, we really appreciate that because, my gosh,
as tough as it is on everybody. To be an athletic director this time is just, I can't imagine how hard that is right now.
No, you're absolutely right. Coach Wheeler, we appreciate your time this morning. Best of luck the rest of the way to your Cobden Apple Knockers. And it's been a pleasure having you on the show.
I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, take care and have a good weekend. Good luck. Bye-bye. Coach Wendell Wheeler of the Cobden Apple Knockers. I would love to see them play, Danny.
Oh, that'd be a great team to see play.
And, boy, it's a shame they didn't get to play Massac County. That would have been good.
Yeah, and, you know, that's one of the things right there that is terrible. Here's a small school. I don't know what their enrollment is, but I bet you it's less than 120 kids.
Probably.
And they've got a lifetime team here that's not going to get an opportunity to bring the excitement and thing to that community down there.
Probably the best team they've had since that old original Cobden Apple Knockers bunch that went to state, you know, way back when. Man, you know, 6'7" point guard, 6'10" guy on the post.
And a 6'6" kid that's pretty dang good.
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty special. You just don't
and
have this 1A
basketball, that'd be pretty dominant.
Well, it's pretty dominant on any level, but 1A especially. So, yeah, you just you have to pinch yourself and think, boy, what if there was postseason this year?
Would-haves, could-haves,
yeah, what would they be doing? I mean, that's amazing. All right, it's a busy day of basketball. I'm headed to the Mule Barn in Fairfield as Fairfield will be hosting the Wayne City Indians in a single varsity game at 12 noon on AreaSports.net. Danny is headed to McLeansboro, and you've just got a marathon of games today. You want to run through those?
Got six games today starting at noon. We'll have varsity girls against Johnson City, and then we'll have JV girls at 3 o'clock. We'll have boys varsity. Follow that up with a JV game against Johnson City. Then at 6:30 tonight, NCOE will come for a JV contest at 8 o'clock varsity. So we'll have it all live if we can endure the endure the struggles today.
You better give Billy an energy drink or something.
I think we may all need energy drinks.
Yeah, might need it. All right. So if you want to see some basketball today, you can flip back and forth between both websites. That's foxesfans.net or areasports.net. We'll have plenty of basketball.
That'll be seven games for us in 24 hours.
That's right. I'm glad you're doing 6 to 7. Hey, we'll be back here to do it again. The Sports Couch. 90 minutes of great local sports talk every Saturday morning at 8:30 right here on AreaSports.net. Have a great weekend, everybody. So long.